This is a good day to come before the Lord, showing our dependence on Him and our adoration for Him. We begin this service with a call to worship from Psalm 24. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Let's come before the Lord with worship.
Be of good courage. the victory is always His. He will protect you wherever you go. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and be of good courage, for He is your guide. Be strong.
It is good for us to show our dependence on God through prayer. Will you pray with me? Our great God and Heavenly Father, mighty are You, and also gracious to us. We come to You with confidence because Jesus Christ has opened the way through the veil, inviting us into the Holy of Holies, where we commune directly with You. We are mindful of our sinfulness, and we confess this to You. We also are mindful of our weakness, and so we bring our petitions. Our Father, we pray that You would bring peace to our world. We ask that You would give comfort to those who mourn, especially those who are part of the Commonwealth Nations after the passing of the Queen. And we pray, Father, that You would give wisdom and grace to King Charles, as he now has ascended the throne. And we pray for the governments in our countries, for prime ministers and presidents, that they might govern with a sense of duty to You as well as to the people, and that their decisions might be right and just. We pray, Father, for the courts in our lands, that they might make decisions, that they might give verdicts that are true. And we pray, Father, that You would give us freedom from crime and from tyranny. We ask, Lord, that You would bring an end to war, especially the war in Ukraine. We also pray that You would give a strength of faith and perseverance to those who are being persecuted in China, in Myanmar, in North Korea, in the Middle East, in various parts of the world. We pray about the restriction of freedom of speech in Western countries, that this would be reversed, and that the opportunity, the freedom to proclaim the whole truth of Your word would be available. Lord, we pray that it might find listening ears. We ask that men and women and boys and girls would turn to Jesus Christ for salvation and would find lasting hope in Him. We pray for our missionaries that they might be bold in proclaiming Your truth today. Lord, for those who are in hospital, we pray that You would restore health. For those who are enduring chronic pain or sickness, we pray You would be their companion. And we ask the same for those who are in aged care and who are lonely. We pray for those who are troubled in their soul that You would give them relief. We pray that You would show the sufficiency of Your grace. And Lord, we ask for those who are working in the medical profession or in emergency services or in our armed forces that You would protect them and that You would give them strength for their responsibilities. Thank You, Father, for hearing our prayer. Help us in all things to have courage in You. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
To make a wretch His treasure.
Turn today to the book of Hebrews. So if you'll take your Bible, please turn to Hebrews chapter 12. Now as we come to verse 12 through verse 17, we have some additional instructions about the race. You notice from verse 12, and I'll read it here, it says, "Wherefore lift up the hands which hang down." That word "wherefore" is repeated from verse 1, where we read, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight," those are good things that can get in the way of the best, "and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." So the author has resumed this metaphor of the race, and now we'll refine our understanding. And the biggest part of the refinement is this. The race, yes, it's a relay, but more importantly, it is a group race. We run this race in community. And that's why I've titled this sermon, Running in Formation. We don't run it alone. We run with others, specifically those who are part of our church. We run with them, and our goal is for all of us to cross the finish line together. What we find in these verses is a threefold responsibility. You have a responsibility for yourself. You've got to put in the effort for yourself and win in resilience. Win in resilience. The second responsibility is you have a responsibility for others, for those around you, those who are part of your church. You have a responsibility for them and win in relationship. Win in relationship. And then thirdly, you have a responsibility to the race itself, the integrity of the race. And you must run that race according to the rules. So win according to the rules. Let's look at verses 12 and 13, which is about your responsibility for yourself to win with resilience. "Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees." This is talking about your hands, your knees. "And make straight paths for your feet." Who makes the straight paths? You do. "Make the straight paths for your feet,
lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. You must run. It's your responsibility. It doesn't come automatically. Now, the race is very difficult, and that race is unique. It's a race God has set out for you. So even though we're running it as a group, the group isn't all running the exact same pathway. And yours will be different to the person next to you, but the destination is the same. It is arduous. There are hills to climb. There are hurdles to cross. And you will get weary. The Christian life is not a picnic. It is a battle. It is warfare. And you will get weary. And your hands at times will hang down, and your knees will become feeble, and your path may be tempted to become crooked and to get off. These are the three things you must guard against as you run with resilience. You win with resilience. Take responsibility for this. So let's have a look at these three pitfalls from these verses we've read. First is the hands that hang down, or they droop in hopelessness. They droop in hopelessness. Now, this is something that happens to all of us. We get tired. We lose sight of the final objective, and we start to slow down, or we might even stop. Now, this, your hands hanging down, that means your hands not serving, not stretched out straight to serve God and other people, but rather just being limp and being of no particular purpose. Are your hands hanging down at the moment? Are you actively involved in service for the Lord? If you are not, it's time to lift up those hanging hands. Next, we see the knees that weaken in weariness. The knees that weaken in weariness. That word feeble means paralyzed. And so we've stopped running. And that's an experience every runner has. There comes a time when you're weary and you're not sure that you can go on. And that happens in sport. And you've got to kick in and go to the next level. And spiritually speaking, it is the same thing. Now, for this passage, the author quotes from Isaiah 35. And that chapter, if we look at the context of it, shows the illogic of feeble knees. We need to kick it in, and we've got every reason to do it. So the quotation comes from verse 3 of chapter 35, which reads, "Strengthen ye the weak hands and confirm the feeble knees." So you see how that's the quotation. But now I want you to see the context. And I want you to ask yourself, is this context about losing or winning? Is it about being weary, or is it about being energized, having momentum, gaining momentum in the competition? Verses 1 and 2, same chapter. "The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellency of Carmel and Sharon, they shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God." Are words like glad, rejoice, blossom, glory, excellency, are those terms of defeat or victory? This is all about victory. And so this is the illogic of the feeble knees. Yes, physically, we're worn out. And we're weak, and we are feeble, but the race is being won. And so just as a sport team will kick it in at the end, and will seize on that momentum, and will go beyond what they think is possible, let's see that we are winning the race. Let's embrace the momentum, and let's keep going. Let's keep running. Now, you may be feeling that weariness right now. I want to encourage you from that same Isaiah 35 context with verse 4. "Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not." This is the coach saying to you, be strong, Fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He will come and save you. That is our reassurance. Then we come to the part about the feet that stumble in waywardness. Running straight and avoiding hazards that will trip you up and make you lame, that also is essential. The rugby league finals started this weekend. Ball carriers are taught in rugby league to run north and south, not to be dancing around behind the line and trying to get around people and avoid being hit, but rather to run straight down the field and gain as much as you can, even though it's going straight into the teeth of the defense. And that's what we must do as Christians in this race of life. We've got to run straight, because if we get off, we dance around, we try to avoid these other things, we're going to end up twisting our ankle, so to speak, and becoming lame. Waywardness never satisfies. It always injures. So will you lift up your hands in service to others? Will you keep the knees pumping, going in the race, even though you have moments of weariness? Will you refuse to get off track, but will you keep your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, and run straight? The second responsibility is to others. You need to win in relationship. Verse 14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently lest any man fail of the grace of God. There are three areas of responsibility, each set off with this common phrase. There's all men, there's no man, and there's any man. You see that in those verses? The all men, what's the responsibility? Be at peace with all men. You are responsible to be at peace with all men. Now, it says follow there. That word follow doesn't mean a passive, we're just along for the ride. It means actively stepping in the footsteps of Jesus. You may have had a child or a grandchild following behind you, and maybe you're walking on the beach, and they're taking these long strides in order to step in the very footsteps that you have left for them. That's the picture. We actively follow the footsteps of Jesus. You could use the word pursue here. Pursue peace. Peace. Whose responsibility is it to be at peace in our relationships with other people? It's your responsibility. Yes, it's true, you cannot control what other people do. And sometimes people do things that are hurtful to us. Sometimes crimes are committed against us. And we cannot control, we cannot prevent those things from happening. But we do control our reaction to them. And we can choose to live at peace. Now, I want to explain what this peace is and also what it is not. But first, let's have a look at Romans chapter 12, verse 18, which says the exact same thing. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Now, this is an honest verse. We cannot control if others want to be in conflict with us, but we can control our response and whether we will actively be in conflict with them. So as much as it depends on us, let's be peaceable. Let's be forgiving. Let's be gracious towards other people. Let's cut people slack. Let's not be nitpicking at every little thing. Let's live at peace with others. But we cannot control if they refuse to live at peace with us, and we won't feel responsibility for that. What we're talking about with this peace is the absence of interpersonal conflict. Interpersonal conflict is the bane of churches, of missionary teams, of Christian groups. When interpersonal conflict is allowed to exist, it is like gangrene that spreads and always destroys. So we must actively follow after peace. We must be peace agents. As we saw from the Sermon on the Mount 2 weeks ago, a son of God is a peacemaker. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. So will you pursue peace? You're also responsible in relationship to live in holiness with God. And the word there also is other-oriented, because it says, no man, don't allow any man to live outside of holiness. This is a necessary balance to peace. Some people think peace, that's necessary at any cost. No, we have to balance peace and holiness. We saw an example of this last month in the Anglican Church here in Australia. The Anglican Church has been in conflict for many years because some segments are conservative. They believe in Jesus Christ as Savior. They hold to the Word of God. They preach the Word of God. We've got a couple doctrinal differences with them about creation and about the end of the world, but there are a lot of similarities between them and us, this conservative branch of the Anglican Church in Australia. They preach the gospel. They preach God's Word, and they stand courageously on it. We appreciate that. But the majority of the Anglican churches in Australia are the exact opposite. They're more Catholic than they are Anglican. And this is a bit different to the Catholics. They have embraced same-sex marriage, much like the Episcopal Church in the United States. And so there's this conflict, and it came to a head this last month when same-sex marriage, the endorsement of it, was approved by the broader Anglican Church. In response, the conservative wing of that church is now pulling out. They're forming their own denomination. Is this wrong? Shouldn't they pursue peace? No, not when truth and holiness are at risk. We must stand for holiness. There's no command from God to have peace at any cost. We cannot have peace if it means compromise. And so I commend them, those pulling out of the Anglican Church, for standing for the truth of God's Word. And we must do the same. Holiness is required. And then our responsibility extends to watchfulness. Watchfulness for any. And it's for any man, because all of us are susceptible, including ourselves. And so we need to look out for one another. Now, this looking out is not in judgment. It's not nitpicking. But rather, it's looking out in care and concern. It's just like a surf lifesaver at the beach. The surf lifesaver actively scans the horizon for any sign of a swimmer in distress, someone who is drowning, and then they go and they save them. The surf lifesaver is not scanning the horizon to critique the swimming technique of people out in the water, nor the bodyboarding technique of people out in the water. No, that surf lifesaver is looking for one thing and one thing only. Is there someone in distress who needs my help? So they're not being judgmental. They're being discerning. They're being caring. They're being watchful. And we must do the same, because we are running the race, and the race is hard. And sometimes there's someone who stumbles or there's someone who falls, and we must go to them to help them back up again. Not to condemn them or criticize them, but to be watchful, because we want all of us to finish the race. I saw a relay race on television. It was a relay race between groups. And I think this picture is what this text is talking about. There was one group that had a young lady who fell. She twisted her ankle and she could not run anymore. What did they do? Two of the men went back and they carried her the rest of the way through the obstacles and across the finish line. They made sure all of them finished together. And that's what watchfulness means in the church. Let's all finish together. So the first area of responsibility is to yourself. Will you lift up those hands in service? Will you keep those knees pumping even when you're weary? There's every reason to do it because we've got positive momentum. Second, we're responsible for others. Will you live at peace? Will you also keep that standard of holiness? And will you be watchful to bring it all together? Let's all finish together. And then the third area of responsibility in the race is to win according to the rules. We must win according to the rules. The integrity of the race, we're responsible for that. Verses 15 to 17. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled, lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. No one wins a race unless he or she competes according to the rules. Paul said that in 2 Timothy chapter 2, and that is true. We have a responsibility to the integrity of the race. We must win according to the rules. Now, in those verses I just read, three times there is the word lest. Lest, lest, lest. And all of these are flagging grounds for disqualification. Let's be very careful about this. The first grounds for disqualification is failure in the grace of God. Failing in the grace of God. What's it mean to fail in the grace of God? Well, there are various ways we might fail in the grace of God. We might be self-confident. We might be self-sufficient. And instead of relying on God's grace and God's enablement, we go it alone. We can run this race, and we do it in our own strength. That's going to fail of the grace of God because we've abandoned it. Another way we can fail in the grace of God is ingratitude. As we're on the racetrack and we're running, we might get a bad attitude and we might complain about this and about that and why is it like this for me and how come it's so hard, and we might be complaining, complaining, complaining. Our complaining is an expression of ingratitude for the grace of God that's brought us this far. Ingratitude for the greater part that he saved us from our sin, that he suffered in our place. Ingratitude. If you find yourself complaining, that's failing of the grace of God. And another way that we can fail of the grace of God is indulging in ungodliness and in worldly lust. And this we get from Titus chapter 2, verse 12, which says, the grace of God teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. So if we're not denying those things, if instead we are indulging, then we are failing of the transformative grace of God. Are you failing or are you succeeding? Let's stay in the grace of God. The second lest is about fighting. Lest there be fighting, infighting. Again, interpersonal conflict. But even beyond that, it says, lest there be a root of bitterness. A root of bitterness. Becoming a faction. Becoming an enemy of someone who is a team member. We must never allow that to happen. There's never justification for holding a grudge. Now, there are some Christians who think that you don't have to grant forgiveness unless and until the person comes and asks for it. That is patently false. When Jesus hung on the cross, he looked down at those who were mocking him, those who had nailed him to the cross, those who had wished and called out for his death, and he said this without them asking for it, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And Stephen, when he was being stoned, did similarly. To forgive is divine. And as it is that we are not the judge, it is right, it is helpful, it is necessary for us to be quick to forgive and slow to condemn. Now, when we are not forgiving, That's when the root of bitterness begins to grow. And that root of bitterness hurts you more than it does the person that you're bitter towards. It eats away at you. It even has a physical effect. That's been demonstrated from psychologists. That root of bitterness is defeated by forgiveness. Now, someone might say, how can you forgive if you've been violated? Take, for example, a child that's been molested. Are we expected even to forgive a perpetrator like that? Well, the answer is yes, but we must understand what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is not everything's back as if nothing happened. Forgiveness is releasing my compulsion to get revenge. Forgiveness is trusting God to look after it and for myself to release my compulsion to get revenge. So forgiveness does not automatically mean everything goes back the way it was before, and especially in a case where someone has been violated. If you've been violated, forgiveness does not mean that you welcome the perpetrator with open arms and you pursue a renewed relationship with them, if you even had a relationship to begin with. No, forgiveness is releasing them from your desire for revenge. But it doesn't mean that you have to go and be close to that person and pretend it never happened. It's okay to take those precautions, to have a safe distance between. In fact, in the case of a crime like that, it's necessary. Forgiveness. Will you leave things with God? Will you be careful not to be disqualified because of a root of bitterness growing inside? And then the third lest is about fornication, and it uses Esau as an example. Fornication. Fornication is indulging our appetites. Now, there are good things that God has given to us to enjoy, but if those become our reason for living, then we're going to fornicate. He's given to us intimacy, and that's a good thing when it's within marriage. But if we become obsessed with that, and we pursue that, we don't restrain our appetite, we just let it run wild, then we're going to be disqualified. How many Christian young people have compromised and have married an unbeliever because of not restraining this appetite? Even more so, how many people have not waited till their wedding night because of not restraining this appetite? Now, I hasten to add that God is forgiving. And if this is something that is in your past, claim 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sin, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And being cleansed, let's learn to restrain our appetite. That's one appetite. Food's another appetite. That's the one that Esau had a problem with. He was craving a morsel of food, and he wanted that food now. He wanted the instant gratification. And so he sold Jacob his birthright to get a bowl of pottage. Was that a fair exchange? That was absurd. That was absurd. But so unrestrained was his appetite that he did something completely illogical, and he gave up his birthright for that instant gratification. Now, we've got to be careful of that. Some of us have trouble with binge eating or nervous eating. When there's something that is stressing us out, we do that stress eating. That's an unrestrained appetite. Gluttony is a sin. Drunkenness is a sin. We must restrain our appetites. Another appetite that needs to be restrained is the appetite for pleasure or the appetite for prosperity. Now, God gives us good things to enjoy, and God does prosper us. Jesus gives us the abundant life. Now, I'm not talking about material prosperity here and now. I'm talking about the future. Don't expect the riches. The gospel that says God gives you health and wealth, that is a false gospel. Our appetite must be for God, and it must be restrained. Is your appetite being restrained? Because if it's not restrained, it will become grounds for disqualification. Our goal in this race, a race that's both a relay race and it's a group race, is for all of us to cross the finish line together. So will you take responsibility? Responsibility for yourself. Will you, despite your weariness, lift up those hands in service and those feeble knees and running? Will you take responsibility for other people? Will you do your part to live at peace with everyone, to look out for others and to help them if they stumble without sacrificing holiness? And lastly, will you run the race with integrity according to the rules, keeping your appetites restrained and keeping your eyes on Jesus, who is the author and finisher of your faith? Will you run well in the week ahead? Our Father, please help us in this. It is a difficult track, you know that, but we see the destination clearly, and the momentum is strong. Help us to run with perseverance the race you have set before us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Shall I fear to own his cause, or blush to speak his name? Must I be carried to the skies on flowery beds of ease, while others fought to win the prize and sail through bloody seas? Are there no foes for me to face? Must I not stand the flood? Is this my world a friend to place to help me unto God? Sure I must fight if I would reign. Increase my courage, Lord. Supported by thy word.
I hope that you feel encouraged to run the race with perseverance in this week ahead. Jesus Christ is before us, and he is the author and finisher of our faith, so we can run with great confidence and with this knowledge that it will be worth it all when we see Jesus, when we are with him. I want to reassure you as we give our benediction. This comes from the book of Jude, and this is a benediction that speaks to our security in Christ. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling or to keep you from stumbling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.